Good morning and welcome to the Deanery Garden at Canterbury Cathedral on this morning of Wednesday the 23rd of March. This is a really special day and it's a day of national reflection here. It's 2 years exactly since the Prime Minister in an announcement told people that they must stay at home because of the spreading COVID pandemic. It wasn't a pandemic then, it became so afterwards, but we learned that we had to be locked down and only go out in a very limited way at that time. And that now seems a long time ago, but last year on this date we held a day of national reflection, and today we do the same for all those who've lost their lives, not only directly through the pandemic, but during the pandemic, because so many had all kinds of issues with regard to the end of the rhythm of their life. And so this has been called a Daffodil Day, because the Marie Curie organization, the Marie Curie Trust, has the daffodil as their symbol. And at the same time, those nurses went to help so many in the last days and weeks of their life, not just in COVID, of course, they work all the time in hospices and especially at home.
Marie Curie means to me support, dignity and compassion.
Care, compassion and dignity.
Relief, assurance.
Care, support.
Choice and compassion.
I think for me Marie Curie means dignity and compassion and choice.
We were very grateful when Janice walked in the door, mm-hmm. I have to say. My wife was reasonably, although she was terminally ill, nobody would have known until maybe about a month beforehand, when she was admitted to the hospital in Raigmore, which is Inverness, 30 miles away. And I had to hike from bed and breakfast to bed and breakfast, basically trying to find accommodation. Hospitals, although they're great places, they're not very dignified, really. And there's maybe all people in the next bed and what have you, whereas if somebody can come home to their own house, it's so much better, mm-hmm. so much better. And I don't think many families could cope without the help of Marie Curie.
I, as a Marie Curie nurse, go into the homes to give support as well as nursing care to both the patient and to the families, to the carers. We do a lot of listening to the patient as they would talk to us about things that they wouldn't perhaps want to discuss with their relatives. And then also to the relatives as they would ask us or discuss things with us, their fears, their anxieties and their expectations. We try to support them as much as we can, and we want to reassure them that we will help them in any way that we can.
One word would be exhausting. Absolutely exhausting, mentally and physically exhausting. Although you love him to bits and you would do anything, obviously the physical tiredness of not sleeping very well because obviously the stress of it, looking after distressed relatives and neighbours and friends, and then having to deal with the medical side of everything as well is absolutely exhausting. But to have someone come to your home who is honest with you and tells you everything, answers every question, that even the ones that you don't think you should ask, is actually a real relief.
A lot of families says, without Marie Curie, I couldn't possibly have coped on my own. The patients may be up a lot through the night, so they've got to get up with them. But apart from that, the emotional support that we give a lot of the times is why they manage to keep the patient at home. They just couldn't cope on their own.
It's sometimes overwhelming, you know, what people do. You know, the feedback you get, the yeah. job satisfaction. You know, you think, oh, what am I going out and it's snowing? And you think, oh, I'm going to be out there and this time of night. But when you get there, you always know why you do it.
Uh-huh. One of the loveliest things was while Mum was unconscious, how they spoke to her with such respect, how they told her everything that were happening when they were taking her temperature and monitoring her. They spoke to her so affectionately and with so much respect, and really did give her dignity, you know, in those final hours.
I come by the shop, go down the shop brae, under the railway bridge, over the other bridge and left up the glen. And I had to park the car and walk along a track but beside a loch in a wood to see how this old lady who was 80, over 80, was. And when I got there, I saw her on the roof, fixing her roof. And I had to shout up, "How are you?"
There was one lady who used to have a bath about 3 o'clock every morning and wanted her rollers in and her hair set before her husband got up. Patients, when they have cancer, lose so much as time goes on. They very slowly lose their independence and everything around them changes. So their body image is very, very important to them, and especially for this lady who was a very proud lady. So it was a major boost for her to be able to be sitting up in the morning looking $1 million when her husband walked into the room.
To have somebody come to your house who is going through, you feel that they know exactly what you're going through and they know exactly what they need to be doing next and exactly what they can do to help you. And that, I cannot explain what a relief that is to have somebody like that in your home.
I just feel that Marie Curie is a service which should be free to all. We're talking about terminally ill patients, but we're now expanding that into those who have other life-threatening illnesses. So it's not just terminal cancer. And I think it's important that people have choice. That is the main thing, that people have choice. There's no right or wrong as to where to die. There's not. It's not as if the hospital is wrong. It's not. It's having the choices to go to a hospital or a hospice or to be in your own home. And I think that is the most important thing, having the choice.
Marie Curie nurses go out into patients' homes and nurse them so that they could stay at home.
The place most people want to be.
This service is always free of charge.
Marie Curie helps people to live their lives the way they want to until they die.
And those nurses last year looked after 40,000 people in this nation and helped families to have those who were going towards the end of their life still at home, with the nurses giving them confidence, or else in hospices. So the daffodils this morning are a sign of that kind of hope and care. And we give an enormous thank you to the Marie Curie Trust, and they are sponsoring this day. So at the same time, the yellow ribbons, which are being tied around trees all over the nation today, and I can tie one here onto this tree by me, are signs of people remembering. Now, this is a day of national reflection and recollection of those who've died in the pandemic. But of course, since then, in these last weeks, really, this terrible war has broken out. And in the United States, there's always been a tradition of tying yellow ribbons round trees in memory of those who are away, and especially those who have gone away to be in active service in wars in other lands. There's a famous song, "Tie a Yellow Ribbon Round the Old Oak Tree," about a soldier who is coming home and has said to his wife in waiting for him, "If you want me back after this time, then tie a yellow ribbon round the old oak tree and I'll see it." And he's on the bus and he's had no word from his wife, and he can hardly bear, good morning Robin, he can hardly bear to look at the tree. And then as he approaches home, he almost hides his eyes, and then everyone starts cheering, because there's not just one yellow ribbon, there are 100 yellow ribbons all over the oak tree saying he is very welcome back and their relationship is sound and all of that.
Get about us, put the blame on me. bus driver, please look for me, 'cause I couldn't bear to see what I might see. I'm really still in prison in my love.
But this morning we're thinking not only of those. At 12 noon we shall keep a minute's silence for those who've died during the 2 years of the pandemic, and there are really countless millions across the world according to the World Health Organization. But we remember them, and we remember all those who still feel grief because of their passing, and at the same time we continue to pray for and remember all those caught up in this terrible war. So let's add a blue ribbon too, and I can tie it, let me find another branch to tie it on, tie it up here. And this blue ribbon, of course, means that the yellow and the blue give you the colours of Ukraine and places like Mariupol, suffering so much, and really now the whole city, although still resisting, is a heap of ruins. Hardly any building is left standing. So let's say our prayers on this very significant day. The day began with the most beautiful sunrise. This could be a day really in early May. It is so warm, and it's bringing the leaves on the apple trees out. It's bringing more and more flowers out, and I'm surrounded by blossoms of different kinds, both of the bulbs, which have been fantastic this year, but also of the wildflowers. There's a whole clump of primroses beside me here, and everything is flowering. Cowslips here, oxlips, and various other things which are blooming, and a whole bed of hyacinths and tulips. But the daffodils hold the day today, for this is Daffodil Day. And if one thinks then of the colour of the daffodil, of hope and remembrance, then at 12 noon there will be a silence for the nation, and a bell will toll at the end of that silence. But then tonight at 8 o'clock we're asked to light another yellow sign, a candle, in our windows, which we certainly shall do in memory of those who've died. And many in the pandemic had to die in the lockdowns without the comfort of their families near them visiting constantly because of the separation that was insisted upon at that time. So let's say our prayers, remembering back on all those things in the pandemic, remembering those still suffering, for it's still very much a feature and there are areas of the world still in lockdown, and remembering also all those who are praying so hard for the people of Ukraine, whether they have left their homes, left people behind, or are still there in grave danger from all the bombardments going on. So we begin our prayers on this Lenten day, but I'm bound to say with all these daffodils and things, it feels much more like Eastertide with warm weather. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Hear our voice, O Lord, according to your faithful love. According to your judgment, give us life. Blessed are you, God of compassion and mercy. To you be praise and glory forever. In the darkness of our sin, your light breaks forth like the dawn, and your healing springs up for deliverance. As we rejoice in the gift of your saving help, sustain us with your bountiful spirit, and open our lips to sing your praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God for ever. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. And as we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. Our psalm this morning, on the 23rd morning of the month, is Psalm 112. Blessed are those who fear the Lord and have great delight in his commandments. Their descendants will be mighty in the land, a generation of the faithful that will be blessed. Wealth and riches will be in their house, and their righteousness endures forever. Light shines in the darkness for the upright. Gracious and full of compassion are the righteous. It goes well with those who are generous in lending and order their affairs with justice. For they will never be shaken. The righteous will be held in everlasting remembrance. They will not be afraid of any evil tidings. Their heart is steadfast, trusting in the Lord. Their heart is sustained and will not fear until they see the downfall of their foes. They have given freely to the poor. Their righteousness stands fast forever. Their head will be exalted with honor. The wicked shall see it and be angry. They shall gnash their teeth in despair, but the desire of the wicked shall perish. It's a fine psalm to say today. The righteous will be held in everlasting remembrance. This is a day of remembrance, this daffodil day of memory, and a memory also of the wonderful care given by those helping to comfort and make every day count, as they say in hospices, and the Marie Curie nurses are very much full of that kind of intention, and we give thanks for them as they carry on their work. So we're going to our reading this morning and taking up from where we left off yesterday in St. John's Gospel, and this today very much is St. John's Gospel, and it's verse 12 of chapter 8, and we're reading from verse 12 to verse 30. Again Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So the Pharisees said to him, You are bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true. Jesus answered, Even if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true. For I know where I came from and where I am going. But you do not know where I come from or where I am going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Yet even if I do judge, my judgment is true, for it is not I alone who judge, but I, the Father who sent me. In your law, it is written that the testimony of two people is true. I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me. They said to him, therefore, Where is your father? Jesus answered, You know neither me nor my father. If you knew me, you would know my father also. These words Jesus spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple. But no one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. So Jesus said to them again, I am going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I am going, you cannot come. So the Jewish authorities said, will he kill himself, since he says, where I am going, you cannot come? He said to them, you are from below. I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. So they said to him, who are you? Jesus said to them, just what I have been telling you from the beginning. I have much to say about you and much to judge. But he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world what I have heard from him. They did not understand that he had been speaking to them about the Father. So Jesus said to them, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. And he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him. As Jesus was saying these things, many believed in him. Well, once again, we are in the heartland of the fourth gospel, of St. John's gospel, because here, more than anywhere else, is that sense of this gospel being acted out on two different levels and planes. And we've seen that right from the beginning. And that exercise of being on two different levels becomes very, very evident at this time. We've said that right from the beginning, the gospel works with Jesus speaking in an earthly way, but using everything of the Creator's gifts on earth, and we're surrounded by his beautiful gifts this morning with all these flowers, but the flowers are here, growing from the earth, whereas the yellow ribbons and the blue ribbons are really from the heart and part of everything that we reach out to in that which is beyond, in remembrance and in memory. And this whole passage begins with that wonderful statement, I am the light of the world. Something one can say as one sees a sunrise this morning coming up in golden glory at this time of year. One can say, as with Jesus, that he is the light of the world, and that the sunshine is one of the great testimonies, one of the great signs which speak beyond in a spiritual capacity. Just as over the altar, when we're holding the bread, we lift it up as a sign that Jesus is the light of the world, the one who speaks of that which is beyond, but gives us plentiful signs, not only in bread and wine and water, which will be the sign when Jesus is lifted up on the cross at the end of this gospel, but in the sign of everything around us, which Jesus is speaking of plentifully and referring us in different ways back to those parables in the other gospels. So all these things Jesus is speaking of, but he is speaking on an earthly plane of heavenly things, and is seeking to give in word and works the message that the Father, the Creator, has given him. so that the witness to Jesus is in the words he speaks and in the works he does, but it's a witness from the creator of all life, and that I am the light of the world is underlined by that witness. The witness is from heaven, but on earth, God's power and the qualities of the kingdom of heaven are lived out in human life and human thinking in the person of Jesus. And how hard the people, including the 12, we keep saying this, find it to realize that. For we are of the earth in an earthly way. You are of the flesh, says Jesus. This means the same. Flesh and blood are humanity, our mortal lives, but at the same time, that flesh and blood is able to perceive and receive the gifts of the Spirit. But all this is held out in a concept of the Father being in charge of time. My hour has not yet come. And this is spoken in the treasury of the temple, that his hour has not yet come. Heaven will choose the hour when the Son of Man is lifted up, and it will be in a surprising way that Jesus is glorified, and it's towards that image of the cross and the lifting up of the Son of Man that we are really for the first time directed today with Jesus's words in verse 28. Jesus said to them, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, let's go back to what that really means, the representative of our humanity, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. And we're told at that point, as he said it, many believed in him. Somehow the message was beginning to get through, but it would have to wait because the hour has not yet come, and at the same time they've not arrested him yet because his hour has not yet come. Do you want to come up? And at that moment we have more than ever the sort of sense of the two planes that Jesus is working on, the two levels, the level of our own physical activity, our mortal life, which is, of course, every day journeying towards an end, our ability to think and puzzle things out, which gives a key to the signs, but those signs only received properly through the gift of the Spirit with our spiritual perception. And that day will come in this very gospel when the Spirit is given. This is, as I've said, a day of memories. And as we remember what has happened since this day, 2 years ago, not just in this land, but in your own lands, there'll be different dates when you went into lockdown. There won't be many who didn't or aren't at the moment experiencing lockdown. And so this day, let it be a symbol for you as we say our prayers, for in this nation, it was on this day that our Prime Minister said, everyone now must stay at home. Draconian government powers, but for everyone. That became a sign of attempting to give them protected status and good health. We knew so little about the pandemic at that time. The hunt for vaccines was on, and healthcare itself, the workers in healthcare were putting themselves in immense danger. And people really taken into special hospitals, people looking all over for the equipment and the resources to look after so many being hospitalized at that time. A good time to remember. One remembers, I think, on every Thursday night at a particular time, coming out and standing in the garden, because we weren't allowed to communicate with one another, but there was a particular time on that evening when we would come out and bang kettles and pots and everything else to make a huge sound to communicate our thanks to all those health workers. who were giving themselves both danger and very long hours to help the health of the nation. And you will feel that experience in your own communities wherever you are this morning as you're saying your prayers with us. It's an act of memory going back, but it's a reflective act. And that silence at 12 noon, and also the lighting of the yellow candle flame tonight, a sign of hope, but a sign also which says, and you could say this if it is of your own faith and you light the candle, Jesus is the light of the world. For this day in St. John's Gospel, we've read him saying just that in one of his amazing I am statements. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Jesus is calling us to new beginnings, but sometimes those beginnings have, shall we say, hard birth pangs, and there is pain in them as well. And we think of that so much with this as we tie our yellow ribbons around the trees and also add the blue ribbons as a sign of our standing beside those facing so much in Ukraine and daring to leave their homes to try to make something of a safe getaway from places like Mariupol, and at the same time risking everything from the bombardments, which are indiscriminate at the moment. So death is all around them. But also we have the capacity, even in those circumstances, to transform death into life by going from our physical state, our mental state, to embrace the gift of the Spirit from one who was lifted up and wounded and died for our sake on the cross. That also we have in these signs this morning on this marvelous little passage we've just read. So let me speak of two dates which happened today, and they are dates of new beginnings. The first in 1956, but let me go first to the 14th of November 1940, at the beginnings of the Second World War, that huge world conflict which was to engulf many more nations. 14th of November 1940 was a time when people here felt very much that they were standing alone in Europe at that time. And on that night of the 14th of November, for 12 hours, 500 bombers raked the city, the medieval city of Coventry in the Midlands of England. And they went backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards, crisscrossing, making sure that everything in the middle would be destroyed. Many, many people died. Many, many people were injured. Many, many homes were destroyed. And amongst the things destroyed on that night was Coventry Cathedral, an ancient cathedral of huge beauty. And you will remember how we've told this story before. The provost of Coventry the next day went into the ruins of the cathedral and at that time took the nails from the destroyed roof, and they were made into the shape of a cross, and that cross would be a sign of reconciliation, with two charred timbers behind the altar, for the walls of the old cathedral stood still around him. But at that time, the city was waking to the most terrible sight, having had the most appalling experience, which is now being replicated in the cities of the Ukraine. And as we pray for those cities, we remember Coventry and the words inscribed behind that wooden cross, Father, forgive. And then also the cross of nails, which has now become the sign of a worldwide community of reconciliation. Those who wear the cross of nails and say the prayer of the cross of nails. And very often, if we're in the Berkeley Divinity School at Yale, they have a time of saying that they belong to the cross of nails, and it becomes an enormously moving experience. So we this morning remember in our prayers Andrew McGowan, the Dean of Berkeley, and his wife Felicity there, and all the community of Berkeley Divinity School at Yale, who are members of the Cross of Nails. But that Cross of Nails had its origin in those ruins following a night of horror. Let me then come to this day, which is the 23rd of March, and now we're in 1956. And on this day, our Queen, Elizabeth II, laid the foundation stone of a brand new cathedral. There'd been much discussion whether they would attempt to rebuild the old cathedral or move to a place like St. Mary's Warwick, which isn't too far away and is an enormous church in its own right, so that nothing would really have to be done. They would just shift the cathedral to there, but that wasn't the choice they made. They chose to have a new beginning, but to leave the old ruined walls standing as a sign of reconciliation. And those words, "Father, forgive." And on this day, the Queen went to Coventry and was greeted by an ecstatic city, standing on rooftops and standing in the streets and cheering and cheering and cheering to the echo, as the Queen with Prince Philip and the Lord Lieutenant of Warwickshire, Lord Willoughby de Brooke, went to the site of the cathedral, and there was met by the Archbishop of Canterbury, Dr. Fisher at the time, Geoffrey Fisher, and the Bishop of Coventry, and all the Protestant chapter of the cathedral. And there she laid a foundation stone, a new beginning, a brave act. And one can see her on the old black and white films of the Pathé News saying, "I declare this foundation stone well and truly laid."
Britain's proudest ruin, the shell of Coventry Cathedral, wrecked in the raid which gave a new word to the language of war, awaits the Queen. Lord Willoughby de Broke, Lord Lieutenant of Warwickshire, welcomes Her Majesty and the Duke, and presents the Lord Mayor, Alderman T.H. Dewis. This is a proud day for Coventry, for beside the old cathedral ruins, a new cathedral is to arise, and the Queen has come to lay the foundation stone. Youth organizations line the route to the ceremony. The years since 1940 have dealt kindly with the old cathedral, mellowing its sandstone walls and perpendicular windows. The Archbishop of Canterbury in his coronation cope and the Provost greet the Queen at the crypt door. Trim lawns and paths have replaced the rubble and ashes of war. The Prime Minister is one of the party who accompany the Queen and the Duke to the altar of the old cathedral. As the model shows, the new cathedral with its modern lines will flank the Gothic arches of the old, which is to be left standing. They will be connected by a porch, and from today's ceremony, the route from one to the other is to be known as the Queen's Way. The foundation ceremony begins. On the grey pink sandstone block which Her Majesty is about to lay are inscribed the words of St. Paul, "Other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ."
I declare this stone well and truly laid.
Thus Coventry remembers the past and looks to the future.
And on the stone is carved by a stone carver who is called Ralph Bayer. On it is first of all the fact that Her Majesty has laid it, but on below the text, "Other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ," there on the foundation stone. Well, in the next few years, until the 25th of May 1962, when the new cathedral was consecrated again in the presence of the Queen.
Coventry, a name that rang through the world 22 years ago, rings out anew, for its cathedral is reborn. Epstein's inspired St. Michael conquering the devil seems to link the dawn of faith with this new church, expressive of Christianity in 1962. Now, long after the blitz that destroyed the old cathedral, comes the consecration of the new. In the ruins of the old St. Michael's, the Queen talked with Sir Basil Spence, the architect. She, the clergy and notables, made their way towards the new cathedral. The provost of the cathedral escorted the Queen, the Bishop of Coventry, Princess Margaret. A congregation of 2,000 were in their places. 8 archbishops and 56 bishops represented many churches. And as the presence of the Archbishop of Canterbury indicated, this was a great ecclesiastical event. The superb baptistry window is by John Piper. Graham Sutherland designed the 75-foot-high tapestry on the east wall. The service of consecration was conducted by the Bishop of Coventry.
Welcome to you all.
In God's name, welcome to you.
With his crozier, the gift of Denmark, Bishop Bardsley traced the first 2 Greek letters of the name Christ.
Purify, hallow, and consecrate with the everlasting plenitude of thy sanctifying power.
The bishop proceeded to the consecration of the altar, making a circuit of the holy table and tracing the sign of the cross at the corners and in the center. The congregation were seated as the registrar placed the sentence of consecration before the Queen for her signature.
And at that time, Sir Basil Spence, who'd been knighted during those years, Sir Basil Spence, the architect of the cathedral, but also so many other craftspeople, people like the person who Graham Sutherland, who designed the great tapestry of Christ in glory, which is woven in one total piece, all the way down, huge, it weighs a ton, literally, a huge tapestry, which was effected by the tapestry makers of Aubusson, and as I say, and significant for this gospel, woven all in one piece. And there is Christ in glory, surrounded by the 4 evangelists. And then outside, it's the Cathedral Church of St. Michael, Jacob Epstein's huge sculpture of the Archangel Michael vanquishing the devil. And all those signs and symbols, many of you will have been to Coventry Cathedral, but today was the sign of a brave new beginning in 1956 on this 23rd of March. If I come forward 10 years to 1966, another new beginning was very evident on that date, because on that date, March the 23rd, 1966, Dr. Michael Ramsay, the Archbishop of Canterbury at the time, went to Rome. Now, that doesn't seem strange, but in fact, in those days, in 1966, it was the first meeting of an Archbishop of Canterbury with a Pope, Pope Paul VI, since the Reformation. First meeting for 400 years. So it was a huge step of ecumenical endeavor and also Christian intention to seek for unity, following our Lord's Prayer, that they may all be one, ut unum sint, that they may all be one. And Pope Paul gave to the Archbishop an episcopal ring as a sign of respect and of fellowship. But both were in no doubt about the length of the journey of dialogue that needed to take place after that. And that's been happening ever since as a sign of peace and reconciliation. so that gradually we've drawn nearer and nearer, and we give thanks for all of that. We were talking this week about our friends, the monks and nuns of Beck, and how it's a wonderful thing to say the office with them, because the office of St. Benedict can be said together. There's still a distance to run, but nevertheless, this day marked a fresh beginning, a day of sunrise again for this. And as we think of that tapestry woven in one piece, rather like the tunic that Jesus was wearing, which we shall find when the soldiers dice for it, according to the prophecy at the end of this gospel, is, let's not tear it, it's woven in one piece. I hope you're beginning to find that the Gospel of St. John is woven in one piece. Every thread, every different colour, every image, just as the image of the four evangelists around Christ in glory in Graham Sutherland's marvellous tapestry, and also the crucifixion, the small crucifixion below the figure of Christ in glory, signing that that is how they lift the Son of Man up, so that he can be glorified, and the tapestry shows his glory, but the crucifixion shows what it's cost, as also does the cross of nails now bound into the cross on the altar in the new Coventry Cathedral. Well, all these things are wonderful signs of new beginning, but as I say, some of those birth pangs are very, very painful, and the yellow and the blue ribbons are signs of memory, agony of people whom we've lost, and also intention to seek for a better world in which the qualities of the Kingdom of Heaven, which the ministry of Jesus, woven as one piece, points to at all times. So thank God for a sunrise which reflects, I am the light of the world in our own humanity, in the face of Jesus. Let's say our prayers then on this day, and it's the 23rd of March. So we are praying for the Diocese of Kitgum in the Church of the Province of Uganda. In our own diocese, we're simply joining our prayers with the prayers of the National Day of Reflection, Memory and Intention. And also our intention would be to look at, and we'll put the link on, the website of the Marie Curie Trust and see how those who wear the daffodil constantly at sick beds in people's homes, at hospices, can be helped. And that is a help which sends that care forward on this day of sunlight. And we pray for Archbishop Justin and for Bishop Rose of Dover and for Bishop Emma at Lambeth on this day. Let's then say the prayer for today and then the prayer for Lent before we say the Our Father together. Here's this beautiful collect for the third week of Lent. Almighty God, whose most dear Son, Jesus Christ, went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it to be none other than the way of life and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then Ash Wednesday, as we say it every day. Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing that you have made, and forgive the sins of all those who are penitent. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may receive from you, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So each in our own way, we say the prayer our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. I'm going to have a moment of reflection. but which I've been joined by the robin on this side on the ground here, looking really, really smart and bright in his red waistcoat. How are you this morning? There we are, gone up into the apple tree. And all around, he may be feeding young by now. We're going to listen to a song which was new to me. Fletcher found it this morning. It's called The Light of the World, very aptly, and is sung by Lauren Daigle. And as she sings it, the words appear, and you'll see how apt they are for the message of this morning. I am the light of the world. Christ give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourself, take up your cross daily and follow him, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those whom you love, and those whom you would pray for, today and always. Amen. Well now, before you go away, I've got someone with some good news here with me. You'll remember Julia Campbell, who now a couple of Sundays ago, we heard that she'd had no news of her family in Mariupol, and her mother was there. Now I've got Julia on the phone, and we've got a special message from Julia. So good morning, Julia.
Good morning. It is a very good morning today.
It's a beautiful morning here, and for you as well. I think you're sitting outside too, aren't you?
Yes, I am, in the sunshine.
So I think you've got some good news to share with us. So tell us the story of that good news.
Okay, so today is very, very special day, because finally after 21 days of not knowing anything about my mum, not having heard anything, whether she's safe, whether she's well, today I spoke to her, I heard her voice, and more importantly, I now know that she's safe, she's out of Mariupol, and she's with the rest of my family in a house together outside of Mariupol, and they're safe. They're getting food, and they're looking forward to having a wash, and they are looking forward to not waking up to the sounds of shelling and shooting outside. So they're now listening to the sound of the sea instead, which is not far from the house. So they're all together, and it's just the most amazing feeling to know she's safe.
I think that we all feel that, because so many people from across the world have asked and asked and asked, is there any news of Julia's family? And this morning you've given us the news really as fresh as it can come. You well know that we've been praying here for the last 24 hours from your message, but we could say nothing. And we have been waiting in the same way, and this news is wonderful. So you're feeling really, really choked, I should think, as well as really happy.
Choked, relieved, excited, happy, and looking forward to the future again, and planning the further steps as to how I can get my mum here to be with me.
That is wonderful. We ourselves will not cease to pray for the people of Ukraine, and especially in those places like Mariupol, which are suffering so much. But at the same time, our hearts are as glad as yours, and we feel as choked as you. We shed some tears when this news came through from you. So thank you for agreeing to speak to us all right across the world this morning. We've done a morning prayer on fresh beginnings, and we very much pray that this will be a fresh beginning for all your family and for you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for all your prayers and all your support that you've shown. It really does mean a lot, and it kept me going. Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. I know we shall meet soon, so we wish you well till then, and we wish your family good breakfast and a sense of washing away everything that they have been through.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. So that is really the very best possible news that we could have, and a real answer to prayer of the Blue Ribbons, that Julia's mum is now safe together with all her family and at a place where they can no longer hear the sound of gunfire. That doesn't stop us praying for everyone else in that situation, but it is a lovely sense of a new beginning on this morning, a daffodil morning of national recollection here, and prayers for everyone in any kind of danger the world over. So, you've had a nice morning, haven't you? Dashing about here, no Leo to challenge you, and even the robin to give you a little bit of excitement. There we are. You're going to stay out here in the warmth, yes? Yes? I think you are. You must be careful not to jump on the primroses when you get down.